What about another 20 minutes then?
মা আরো 20 মিনিট।
আর 20 মিনিট।
সোহম চক্রবর্তী, প্লিজ প্লিজ মিউট।
Should we start?
এখনো তো অনেকে জয়েন হয়নি মনে হয়, স্যার 68 জন আছে।
হয়েছে পরের দিন একটু বেশি বেটার প্ল্যানিং করতে হবে, আগে থেকে টাইম শেডিউল করে রাখতে দুখানা পর পর। সো লেট আস স্টার্ট, হ্যাঁ লেট আস স্টার্ট, বিকজ এভরিথিং ইজ বিং রেকর্ডেড। আই উইল শেয়ার শেয়ার দিস ভিডিও অ্যান্ড আদার্স উইল জাস্ট শেয়ার।
ওকে স্যার,
ওকে।
Yes, sir.
So if we hear me, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
We can hear you. Just 1 minute. So this is an ordinary artery, ordinary capillary. In the ordinary capillary, this is the fluid.
Yes, sir.
Right. From the arteriolar end of the capillary, the solute and fluid is moving out from the arteriolar end of the capillary with a net filtration pressure of plus 16 millimeter of mercury. In the venular end of the capillary, it is taken in or absorbed with a negative pressure of minus 14 millimeter of mercury. Here plus and minus is indicating the direction of the fluid movement. So this is in case of ordinary capillary. Now what is happening in case of, so, and this is the picture of an ordinary capillary. This is a picture of an ordinary capillary where in the arteriolar end, the net filtration pressure is around plus 16 millimeter of mercury. And in the venular end, the net absorption pressure is around plus or minus 14 millimeter of mercury. This is plus, that means molecules are going out of the vessel, and this is minus, that means molecule is entering into the vessel. So this is the situation here. Now in case of glomerular capillary, so the modified Starling's equation would be this. This is the modified Starling's equation. This is the modified Starling's equation. That means J is equal to K PGC minus PBC minus Pi GC. GC stands for glomerular capillary and BC stands for Bowman's capsule, and Pi GC is the oncotic pressure of the glomerular capillary. Why I excluded Pi BC, I have already told you. Now, one point I was discussing before our last part got disconnected was that hydrostatic pressure of the glomerular capillary is a bit higher, around 45 millimeter of mercury. Hydrostatic pressure of the Bowman's capsule is around 10 millimeter of mercury, and osmotic pressure of the glomerular capillary is varying between 25 to 35 millimeter mercury. And the reason, as I have mentioned just now, reason is, as from the afferent arterial end, here the osmotic pressure is 25 millimeter of mercury, and when the blood is passing through the glomerular capillary, large amount of protein-free, cell-free fluid is being passed out of the muscular compartment. Accordingly, protein is relatively concentrated, so the osmotic pressure increases in the efferent end of the glomerular capillary. So that's why the osmotic pressure is increasing from 25 to 35 millimeter of mercury. That is the reason. Now, based upon that, if you calculate that at the afferent arterial end, the net filtration pressure would be plus 10 millimeter of mercury, and in the efferent arterial end, the net filtration pressure is zero. So what happens as a result of this, that fluid is coming out of the vessel, but it is not returning into the vessel. In contradiction or in contradistinction to the ordinary capillary, fluid is coming out of the vessel and also returning to the vessel. Whereas in glomerular capillary, fluid is coming out of the vessel, but is not returning into the vessel. This is simply because two important things. In my last class, at the end of my last class, 7 days back, I told you that glomerular capillary is the only capillary which is started with an arteriole and ending with an arteriole. What is the reason? What is the biological advantage of that? The advantage is, as both of them are arteriole, hydrostatic pressure head is maintained unaltered. So the point is, in case of ordinary capillary, at the arteriolar end, hydrostatic pressure is 40, at the venular end, hydrostatic pressure is 10. Whereas in glomerular capillary, in both the end, as because both are arteriole in nature, at the afferent arteriolar end and at the efferent arteriolar end, the hydrostatic pressure remains same, 45 mm. That is the most important thing. As both of them are arteriole, pressure head is maintained. As pressure head is maintained, 45 and 45. And Bowman's capsule hydrostatic pressure is constant, 10. But osmotic pressure is changing, whereas in ordinary capillary, osmotic pressure remains same, 25 millimeter mercury. But in glomerular capillary, osmotic pressure is increasing from 25 to 35, because just I have told you, large amount of protein-free filtrate is formed and the blood becomes relatively concentrated. Blood protein becomes relatively concentrated, as a result of which the osmotic pressure at the efferent arterial end increases. And accordingly, the net filtration pressure at the afferent arterial end becomes 10 and at the efferent arterial end it becomes zero. So fluid is coming out of the vessel but is not entering or returning back into the vessel. So that is the simple justification of what I should say, abdominal filtration. So can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is how the glomerular filtration is formed, and that is the justification. Now, if you see the comparative data,
sir.
হ্যাঁ বলো.
Sir, বলছি এই যে পিকচারটাই যেটা দেখালেন এই এখানে যদি লার্জ অ্যামাউন্ট অফ সেলফি ওয়াটার বেরি মানে সেলফি ফ্লুইড বেরিয়ে যায় তাহলে ক্যাপিলারি হাইড্রোস্ট্যাটিক প্রেসার তো চেঞ্জ হওয়া উচিত মানে ওটা 45ই থাকছে কেন ওয়াটার যখন বেরিয়ে যাচ্ছে তখন মানে ওটা বুঝতে পারলাম না মানে ওটা 45ই থাকছে কেন
ও আচ্ছা ঠিক আছে বলে দিচ্ছি আচ্ছা বুঝতে পারলাম যে তোমার বক্তব্য হচ্ছে যে অ্যাজ দ্য লার্জ অ্যামাউন্ট অফ সেল ফ্রি প্রোটিন ফ্রি সলভেন্ট ইজ লস্ট অ্যান্ড অ্যাকর্ডিংলি অ্যান্ড অ্যাজ এ রেজাল্ট অফ দ্যাট অসমোটিক প্রেসার ইজ ইনক্রিজ ফ্রম 25 টু 35 how the hydrostatic pressure is head is maintained to 45 etai to question
ha sir
okay now point is ordinarily what happens in ordinary capillary in ordinary capillary pressure reduces from 40 to 10 here it is maintained 45 to 45 as because both end are arterial end now there is another point which you have raised that as because there is a loss of fluid then hydrostatic pressure also to be reduced here comes the question I intentionally did not brought that issue but it is a good question now issue is there is a difference between afferent arteriole and efferent arteriole resistance ratio so afferent arteriole end resistance of the afferent arteriolar end and resistance of the efferent arteriolar end they varies and there is a ratio between them if the efferent arteriolar ratio and usually the efferent arteriolar ratio is more than the afferent arteriolar ratio as a result of which in spite of loss of large amount of fluid and as both of them are arteriole and arterioles and having a strong circular muscle coat very strong circular muscle coat both of them can contract and accordingly to that mechanism it is maintained the hydrostatic pressure is maintained at 45 or more or less constant in spite of being a loss of large amount of fluid the hydrostatic pressure is maintained due to the efferent arteriolar constriction on a preferential constriction of efferent arteriole and a rather low efferent arteriolar resistance ratio theek ache bolo আচ্ছা আই উইল কন্টিনিউ আমার ইন্টারঅ্যাকটিভ সেশনে আমি আরো আলোচনা করব ঠিক আছে সো নাও ইফ ইউ রিমেম্বার দ্য আর্লিয়ার ডায়াগ্রাম অফ ক্যাপিলারি ফিল্ট্রেশন ইউ ক্যান সি দ্য ডিফারেন্স বিটুইন দিস দ্য আর্লিয়ার ডায়াগ্রাম ওয়াজ ইজ এ কাইন্ড অফ এ ক্রস ইট ইজ ইন ওয়ান সাইড ইট ওয়াজ 40 ইন আদার সাইড ইট ওয়াজ 10 সো ইট ওয়াজ ক্রসিং বাট হিয়ার ইউ সি ইট ইজ ফ্রম হিয়ার টু হিয়ার অ্যান্ড ইট ইজ সো দেয়ার ইজ এ when a filtration equilibrium somewhere here and at the efferent arteriolar end it is almost zero now if we compare these two diagrams you see in case of a typical capillary so that is the difference between a typical capillary and glomerular capillary in case of a typical capillary fluid is moving out of the vascular system and fluid is getting inside the vascular system. In case of glomerular capillary, fluid is only moving out, but it is not getting in, because there is a net filtration pressure of around 10 millimeter of mercury at the apparent arterial end, which is gradually reduced to reach zero at around 2/3 level of the capillary length, and at the apparent arterial end it is zero. So this is the difference between a typical capillary and a glomerular capillary, and as a result of which large amount of cell poor or cell free, protein free filtrate is formed at the Bowman section. Now, having been understood the mechanism of glomerular filtration, we need to remember some of the other, understand some of the other important attributes of glomerular filtration. As for example, these are the attributes: filtrate to plasma ratio, size principle, charge principle, shape principle, and filtration factor. So these are some of the issues. So what is filtrate to plasma ratio? Filtrate to plasma ratio of a given substance, suppose a substance called X. If filtrate to plasma ratio of X remains 1, then we say it is a freely filterable substance. If the concentration of X, is same in filtrate as also in plasma, that means filtrate to plasma concentration ratio is 1, it is known as freely filterable substance. What are those freely filterable substances? We shall soon discuss. Now, freely filterable substance, what are those freely filterable substance, will depend upon several things, what are known as I've written below, size principle, charge principle, and shape principle. It is not only the size, but also the other things, special shape and charge are also important. So what is, so this is filtrate to plasma ratio. See, this is the filtrate to plasma ratio of different substances. Say for water, water filtrate to plasma ratio is 1. Say for urea, filtrate to plasma ratio is 1. For glucose, filtrate to plasma ratio is 1. For inulin, filtrate to plasma ratio is almost 1. But for protein structure, you see myoglobin, albumin, hemoglobin, serum albumin, etc., the filtrate to plasma ratio is gradually reduced. And in case of serum albumin, it is as low as 0.01. So this is the filtrate to plasma ratio. So actually, filtrate to plasma ratio is a particular parameter. It is a parameter by which we try to understand the processing of various substances by the glomerulus. How various substances present in the plasma is appropriately processed by the glomerulus is being understood. See this important table. See, in one side there is molecular weight in Dalton. In between there is effective molecular radius, and in other side the filtrate to plasma ratio. One very important thing I like to point out. See, difference between hemoglobin and albumin. Difference between hemoglobin and albumin, molecular weight is almost same, 68,000 and 69,000. Hardly 0.1% difference of molecular weight. Effective molecular radius is almost same, 32.5 and 35.5. A little bit difference, around say 3% difference. Whereas filtrate to plasma ratio is 300% difference. Try to see it, 300% difference. So this is a very important feature which we shall discuss today. So this is about the filtrate to plasma ratio. Next is charge principle. What is charge principle? Now charge principle means the glomerular basement membrane is having a negatively charged sialoproteins, which are negatively charged. So it will repel the negatively charged particle, and it will rather attract the cations. Right? So an experiment is conducted by different types of dextran. One is cationic dextran, another is anionic dextran, another is uncharged dextran. Dextran are the polymer, just are the carbohydrate polymer. And we are seeing the effect of increasing molecular radius and filtrate to plasma ratio. See, it is inverse relation. Increasing effective molecular radius will lead to reduced filtrate to plasma ratio. That is quite expected. and everywhere it is so. So as the effective molecular radius is increasing, the filtrate to plasma ratio is also decreasing. Or in other words, as the effective molecular radius is decreasing, filtrate to plasma ratio is increasing. That means the substance is filtered more. But the three lines are of different slope. For cationic dextran, it is better filtered than anionic dextran. Both are keeping the relationship of the effective molecular radius and filtration rate or filtrate to plasma ratio. But for cationic dextran, it is better filtered than anionic dextran. Of same effective molecular radius, 28. If we take 28 as a number, 28 angstrom, for a cationic dextran, there's a high filtration rate. But for an anionic dextran, there's a low filtration rate. For uncharged dextran, there's a moderate filtration rate. So is a charge is an issue. That's because glomerular filtration barrier is negatively charged. A negatively charged particle is repelled and a positively charged or cationic particle is attracted. So this is another issue. This is known as charge principle or electromotive force principle. Next is height principle. Height principle is easy to understand. A molecular weight up to 5000 delton can be easily passed through with an effective molecular radius of less than 15 angstrom. So with an effective molecular radius of around 15 angstrom can be passed easily. If you recollect, when I discussed the filtration barrier, I told you in the epithelial side, the filtration slit is around, the filtration slit was around 250 angstrom. And in the endothelial side, the filtration pores are having diameter of 500 to 1000 angstrom. So in the endothelial side, the pore diameter in the endothelial side is around 500 to 1000 angstrom. And in the epithelial side, the slits are having a gap of 250 angstrom. But a particular solute to pass, its effective molecular radius must be less than 15 angstrom. Otherwise, it cannot pass. Why it is so? Because the glomerular endothelium and Bowman's capsule epithelium, they are rather interdigitating with each other. There's a complex interdigitation, and there are a lot of structural and functional force. There are a lot of shape, size, electromotive force, and there are other unknown factors are also there, which is determining the passage of molecule across the membrane. So what we see finally, that effective molecular radius should be less than 15 angstrom in order to a particular solute to be freely filterable. A particular solute to be a freely filterable, that means F by P ratio, whose F by P ratio is less, is around 1, that means filtrate to plasma ratio to become 1, its molecular effective molecular radius must be less than 15 angstrom. So let us understand the shape principle in a better way. So this is the shape principle I told you, that hemoglobin having a molecular weight of 68,000 and serum albumin having a molecular weight of around 69,000, hardly 0.1% difference. But see, the filtrate to plasma ratio is 300% difference or 3 times difference. Why it is so? Molecular effective molecular radius is also very close, but filtrate to plasma. So that means hemoglobin, although filtered very less, but it is at least 3 times that of albumin. Why it is so? There lies the issue of shape. It is said that hemoglobin is a more compact molecule than albumin, like this. So albumin is rather a kind of an asymmetric structure. So this is a ribbon diagram of albumin and hemoglobin. It expresses the spatial shape or allosteric characteristics. So it indicates the allosteric characteristics. See, in case of albumin, for albumin, it is a rather asymmetrical, whereas hemoglobin is quite symmetrical and more compact in nature. So as hemoglobin shape is more compact in nature, in contradiction to the shape of the albumin, which is more asymmetrical in nature, so this shape is playing certain havoc. This shape is playing certain very important role in determining the filtrate to plasma ratio or whether a substance will pass through or not. So these are shape principle, size principle, and charge principle. Both are very important for filtration purpose. Now finally we come to the glomerular filtration rate. So what is glomerular filtration then? So glomerular filtration is nothing but passage of a corpuscle free and protein free fluid and corpuscle free and protein free plasma across the glomerular filtration barrier by means of which large amount of fluid is entering or coming out. Large amount of fluid is coming out of the vascular space.
Swami, kya kar rahe hain? Nahin sunai de raha sir, jab bol raha
hai. Mute kar do. Achha, large amount of...
Raja, please mute your...
Mute kar do. So, large amount of protein-free, cell-free plasma is being passed from vascular space to extravascular space. And what is the amount? This is the amount. Huge amount. 125 ml per minute or 7.5 liter per hour, and that is amounting to around 180 liters per day. If you just remember, if you just recollect, what is the amount of plasma in our body? Amount of plasma in our body is only 3 liter. So 3 liter of plasma is, whole amount of plasma is filtered every day 60 times. That is 60 times it is filtered. 60 times it is coming out of the vascular space and returning back to the vascular space. Because we all know, although filtrate amount is around 180 liter, what is the amount of urine? Amount of urine is around 1 to 2 liter only. Filtrate is formed, glomerular filtrate is around 180 liter per day, and amount of urine per day is around 1 to 2 liter. That means more than 99.9% of glomerular filtrate is returning back to the circulation. How it is returning back, what is returning back, that we shall discuss under tubular processing soon. So this is about the glomerular filtration rate. What is filtration fraction? Filtration fraction means glomerular filtration rate divided by effective renal plasma flow. We know what is renal blood flow. Renal blood flow is around 20% of the cardiac output, 20% of cardiac output, 20 to 25% of cardiac output. So around 1100 to 1200 ml. Out of that 1100 to, if we take it as 1200 ml, then around some amount is plasma, 55% is plasma. So around 55% is plasma. Out of that 55% of plasma, one is Baroshor 55%. Baroshor 55% koto hai dekhte hobe. So that amount of plasma is passed to the kidney, and out of that amount of plasma, around 10% is passing to the non-filtering zone. That means it is passing to the medulla, some is passing to the capsule, some are passing to the perinephric fat, around 10%. But rest 90% are utilized for the filtration purpose. So renal plasma flow minus 10% is known as effective renal plasma flow. So 10% is passing to the other.
Sir, 55% jayega ta bujhte parlam na.
Kunta bolo?
55% jayega ta sir.
Amader mane paxel volume koto?
1200 sir.
45%? Amader blooder. কত হবে 600 renal cortex. As I have shown you plenty of times. This part is passing to the non-filtering zone. আমি বলেছি 93% cortex, 7% in medulla, 7% medulla চলে গেল। এছাড়া some part is supplied to the perinephric fat, renal capsule. So if we subtract around 10% of that renal plasma flow, that will give you effective renal plasma flow. Effective renal plasma flow. So that effective renal plasma flow, so GFR divided by effective renal plasma flow is around 0.16 to 0.2. So these are very important parameters of renal function. So what are the factors affecting GFR? So the final point is, what are the factors affecting GFR? Factors affecting GFR can be easily deduced by this modified Starling's equation for glomerular filtration. So this is the central theme of our class today. This is the central theme of our class today. J is equal to K PGC minus PBC minus pi GC. This is the central theme. If you remember the each of these attributes, you can easily calculate out or figure out what are the factors affecting GFR. So these are the factors affecting GFR: changes in renal blood flow, changes in PGC, changes in PBC, changes in concentration of plasma protein, changes in KF. So changes in PGC means changes in systemic blood pressure, afferent efferent arteriolar constriction status, and changes in filtration coefficient means changes in glomerular capillary permeability, changes in effective filtration surface area. So these are some of the important factors which we can easily figure it out if we understand the essence of our central theme of our today's class, that is a modified Starling's equation, each and every point. So if just take it, let me take one point, because I have got lack of time. Let us take one point. See, if we take the point changes in hydrostatic pressure of the Bowman's capsule, if we take this point, hydrostatic pressure of the Bowman's capsule, if the hydrostatic pressure of the Bowman's capsule is increased, what will happen? If the hydrostatic pressure of the Bowman's capsule is increased, what will happen? This will increase. If this will increase, the net filtration pressure will fall. So glomerular filtration will be decreased. If the hydrostatic pressure in the Bowman's capsule is increased, this part is increased, this part is increased, it will lead to decrease in GFR. Now let me tell you when this increase. It will increase when it will increase. It will increase. So when the hydrostatic pressure here is increased, if the hydrostatic pressure here is increased, if the hydrostatic pressure here is increased, so hydrostatic pressure here is increased, when it will increase? It will increase if there is any obstruction in the urinary pathway. If there is any obstruction in the urinary pathway, that obstruction will ultimately reflect it back into the Bowman's capsule, isn't it? Every Bowman's capsule, every individual Bowman's capsule is ultimately connected with the ureter, isn't it? Every individual Bowman's capsule is ultimately connected with the ureter. If we see my earlier diagram, if we see the earlier diagram, if we see this earlier diagram, first diagram, so every Bowman's capsule is ultimately connected through the cortical collecting tubule, etc., ultimately connected to the ureter. So if there is any obstruction in the ureter, if there is an obstruction in the ureter, or if there is an obstruction in the junction between ureter and bladder, if there is an obstruction in the urethra, if there is an obstruction in the penile portion of urethra, anywhere, or urethral portion of the urethra, anywhere, if there is an obstruction, that will ultimately lead to a increase in the pressure. That will ultimately lead to increase in the pressure of the that will ultimately lead to so the, in case of every in any case of obstructive uropathy, so if there is any obstructive uropathy, see, this is known as obstructive uropathy. obstruction in the urinary passage. If there is any obstruction anywhere in the urinary passage, that will increase as a back pressure, rise in hydrostatic pressure of the Bowman's capsule. And if there is a rise in hydrostatic pressure of the Bowman's capsule, glomerular filtration will be reduced and glomerular filtration rate will be reduced. So by understanding the various factors affecting the GFR, we can easily deduce out the various disorder or disease affecting the glomerular filtration. And now, last but not the least is the measurement of GFR. It is easy thing, you can yourself read also, it is very easy to understand. I will just mention. So this is basically the nephron equation. Utilizing this nephron equation, we can measure the GFR. So in this nephron equation, if we arrange in such a fashion that this Tx becomes zero, if this Tx is made zero, then what will happen? Then GFR is equal to UxV divided by Px. So if we get any substance which is not transported in the tubule, which is only filtered, which is freely filtered, but it is not transported across the tubule, neither secreted nor reabsorbed. So if we get any substance which is freely filtered, but neither transported, neither secreted nor reabsorbed nor metabolized. If we get such a substance and if we use that substance as a test substance, then we can effectively make the Tx zero, then by measuring the concentration of substance in urine and in the plasma and also the volume of urine per unit time, we can measure out the GFR. And such a substance is known as inulin.
Inulin.
So inulin is a fructose polymer having a molecular weight of little less than 5000, and effective molecular radius is quite low, as I have shown you in the table, and filtered to plasma ratio is close to 1.98. So we use this substance. So inulin, we give a regular infusion of inulin intravenous and achieve a stable plasma concentration of inulin. After that, we measure the urine, we collect the urine and measure the concentration of inulin in the urine and also measure the volume of urine per unit time and measure the plasma concentration of inulin. Then by just placing in this equation UxV, urinary concentration of inulin into volume of urine per unit time divided by plasma inulin, we can deduce out or calculate out the GFR. So this is the inulin test or inulin clearance test. What is clearance? We shall discuss later. But the timing, you remember that the essence is we are effectively trying to make the Tx zero so that we can utilize this formula to do that. Now, inulin is an external outside substance. Ordinarily, what we do, or regularly in the clinical setting, what we do instead of inulin, nowadays we use creatinine. Creatinine is almost near to inulin, but creatinine is to some extent a little bit secreted. Inulin is not secreted, not reabsorbed at all, but creatinine is a little bit secreted. So when we measure GFR utilizing creatinine, there is a chance of a little overestimation. But the advantage is, creatinine you need not administer into your body. Creatinine is an endogenous substance, which is a product of muscle metabolism, which is synthesized in our body, and it is remain in a stable state. So creatinine measurement is easier to perform, and nowadays we measure with the help of creatinine. So that's all for today. I have got another 1 minute left of the second part. So I will organize another meeting tomorrow, class tomorrow, at around, say, after the morning class is over, after Dr. Dipamshu's class is over, we shall arrange an interactive session if you are interested. Let me know. Then I shall arrange another program, another meeting, to understand what we have discussed till now, last class and today's class. In the meantime, both the sessions are recorded. The last 27th session and